I am serving looks, I am serving outfit, I am serving hair, I am serving makeup, I am just giving you everything. Hello, book reading friends, welcome back to my channel, or welcome if you're new. My name is Melanie, and today I bring you episode 1 of Makeup Monday. Now, you probably don't know what Makeup Monday is, and that is because this is a new series that I am incorporating in my channel as of today. The premise of this new series is I do my makeup while I review a book, and whatever makeup look I end up doing, I will try my hardest to capture the essence of the book, whether it's the vibe inside of it, whether it's the cover, a spine, a particular character, whatever it is, we will be doing a full transformation to embody the book as I review it. So I thought it would be a great place to start with Ninth House, which I read quite recently. I definitely wanted to make a dedicated review to it, and also I have never done like a Dark Academia makeover, so I felt like it was a perfect opportunity to kind of knock both of those things out at the same time. Now again, the book in question today is Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. This is her first adult fantasy novel. We will get a lot more into it once I actually start doing my makeup, but just know this is going to be a spoiler-free review of the book. I will go in depth about the writing, the world building, the characters, absolutely everything, my thoughts, my rating. This whole idea came about after I did my books and makeup tag, and a lot of you asked for a second installment, and I honestly was trying to figure out the best way to do that, and it just came to my mind, let's keep talking about books while I do my makeup. If you have yet to subscribe to my channel, don't forget to do so down below for more bookish content. I am constantly uploading videos that I am sure you do not want to miss. I am also live streaming throughout the week, doing my weekly reading sprints, and you can also follow me on all of my social medias, which are always linked down below. And yeah, without further ado, let's get right into it. Okay, friends, we are literally channeling all of the Dark Academia vibes today with the blazer, the turtleneck, the gold accents, the hair. I feel like everything about this screams Dark Academia, so I'm gonna be doing a makeup look today that is gonna fit this whole aesthetic. Now, when I think of Dark Academia, I really do think about sophisticated, fancy, elevated. Those are all of the words that come to mind. It's gonna be something very natural that I totally would see like a college student or somebody from this ambiance wear in regards to makeup. Now, Miss Ninth House, right behind me. Let me tell you a little bit of a synopsis while I put on some illuminating primer beforehand. So in this book, we have Alex Stern, and Alex was the sole survivor of this accident that happened many months in the past, and she is actually constantly living through the trauma of that accident and everything that happened beforehand. And while she is in the hospital, she actually gets approached by one of the higher up people in Yale University to receive a full right scholarship to the university, because Alex has a particular gift that secret societies in Yale in particular would really be able to use to their advantage. Now, Alex from a very young age has been able to see grays, which are essentially ghosts. Now, Alex definitely feels like an outsider. She doesn't feel like she belongs at Yale. She definitely stands out like a sore thumb. Her entire life, she's been cataloged as a punk and as the misfit, as the goth who always dresses in black, who has all of the tattoos, and who was constantly drinking and abusing substances. And now obviously Alex accepts to go to Yale. She accepts the scholarship to get into the secret society, and she starts learning about all of these 9 secret societies that are actually in Yale, and it's overseeing society as well, which is called the Lethe. That is the part of the secret societies that oversees everything, and that is what she is a part of. Now, she has a mentor, which is called Daniel Arlington, which I think is the most clever thing I have ever seen, because everywhere I had seen that this character's name was Darlington. When I go into the book and I found out that this character's name is actually Daniel Arlington, I don't know why I found it so clever, and I don't know why I was so shocked, but I thought it was such a nice thing to do with like the play of names. And so Darlington's job has been technically training Alex and letting her in and all of the scoop and all of the secrets of the secret society to let her know exactly what her task is within it. And little do you know, lo and behold, Darlington completely disappears. Nobody knows where he is. And on top of that, there is a murder that happened on campus that is kind of related to the secret society. So Alex takes it upon herself to figure out exactly what is going on and how exactly it is connected to the secret societies. But the murder mystery, again, takes place in the majority of the novel. And I think it was a really ingenious way to actually world build. Now, I will say this book is a lot heavier on that description, on that setting, but I think that contributes to the whole Dark Academia feel middle of the book. I think without as much description as it had, it probably would have lacked on some aspects of Dark Academia. And I will say, just as the murder in the book with Tara Hutchins actually contributed to world building and allowed Leigh Bardugo to explore each and every one of the houses from the secret societies, Darlington's disappearance also lent itself to establish the sequel of this book, because that is the thing that remains unsolved at the end of this book. And I think even though it is unsolved, we still got a little bit of answers, enough to keep us intrigued for what is to follow. I definitely think, as far as magic systems go, this was so twisty that I was not anticipating how twisty it would be. We have a magic system in which bodies are opened and bonesmen actually check the organs within a person to try and predict patterns to help all these higher up people, whether they are actors, businessmen, lawyers, political figures, and that is essentially how they know how to act or react in their work life and what to anticipate professionally. Beside that, I think it was also really interesting that each of the houses had their specific powers and their specific way of going about their business. Not everyone has the same power, not everyone has the same ability, and each of the houses has a different ritual to take place depending on their area of expertise. So I think there's still definitely a lot to explore with all of these houses, because although we did get a few chapters, a few pages of explanation into how the houses came to be and what exactly they specialize in, I think it will be really, really interesting to further along actually explore and see those things happen real time. If you've been here for a while, then you'd know that my experiences with Leigh Bardugo before have not been the best. I have only attempted to read Shadow and Bone before, and my commentary on that was, I don't feel like this is the age group for the story. And then going into Ninth House, I was a little bit skeptical because I know a lot of people love it, and going into it, I really do think, I don't know if it's the improvement throughout the years or if it's just the writing voice itself of the age group, but her adult writing is so superior to her YA, at least from what I have read. This is obviously Leigh Bardugo's first adult fantasy, and so out of the gate after reading it, I can tell you, I want more. I want more Ninth House, I want more of Alex, and I want more of Darlington and from Dawes. I just want to see all of these characters again. And continuing on that tangent of the writing, because it was so heavy in description, you could definitely picture all of these places. You could picture all of these scenarios very clearly. The atmosphere was built to perfection, in my opinion, because I definitely could imagine myself there, even though I'd never seen the campus. And on top of that, I think the description of smell and sight, it was all so vivid. I also really think the story was well paced. Like, the story could have easily been fast paced, but I think Bardugo did a really nice job at spacing everything out and making reveals where they made sense, holding back where it made sense, describing when it made sense. So I think the writing to me was very consistent throughout the entirety of the novel. I don't think Dark Academia is meant to be fast paced. If anything, I do think it's meant to be kind of slow and then making those big reveals and including those darker themes when need be. But that being said, because there was so much description in the book, I don't know how easy to read I would call this. I think for me, because I was so invested in the story and I'd already read adult books before, it was definitely easier to get into. But I can totally see the scenario where for some people, because of the amount of description in here, it would get draggy, it would get boring, and it would kind of take a little bit longer to finish. And again, when talking about writing, there are so many things I can highlight with this book, because as you can see, I did annotate and there's a lot of pink moments. That means a lot of writing, quotes, moments that I particularly loved with the book. And when describing Trip, which is one of the characters in this book, he is a side character, he's barely in here, it does take a place later on in the story. Alex says, he had the ease of someone who had always been and would always be just fine. A boy of 1,000 second chances. Again, that gives you a little bit more of an insight as to how Alex perceives this world and how she perceives all of these people. Having grown up in a headspace and in a place where she wasn't that well off, where her parents were definitely not in the social status or class as the people that she is now on university with, she definitely has a different outlook on life and she perceives things a little bit differently than your typical privileged person would. And there's also a lot of passages in this book that really highlight how class and power can get you out of situations, or by yourself into situations. And that is all really highlighted with everything that goes down in all of these secret societies, in all of these acts, like these heinous acts that all of these secret societies commit, like mutilation and torture and murder, and they all get away with it, all because all of their alumni are actually in higher up places. All people who can make stuff disappear just with the blink of an eye. There's also themes in here of classism and xenophobia. We have, to keep the rabble out, the soldiers came back to New Haven from the war wild, most of them unmarried, a lot of them messed up from fighting. There was a wave of immigration too, Irish, Italians, freed slaves, everyone looking for manufacturing jobs. Yale didn't want any of it. And there's of course a lot of talk about corruption as well, and how people within the police force are always covering up all of these things happening in Lethe, in all of these secret societies, just because they can. So I really do think the plot of the story lent itself to include all of these themes that needed to be addressed, things that actually happen in real life, and I think fitting it in this fantasy setting with secret societies and all of these, again, atrocious things that they're doing, was a really ingenious way to provide some social commentary within the book. And I think that aspect of it really contributed to the plot being 10 times more interesting. And you know me, the fact that there was a murder mystery definitely made it even more engaging, just because those are stories that I enjoy reading. I like playing detective, and I will admit, I did not guess what the plot twist was in this book. None of them, because there were actually several plot twists in this book. I could not foresee any of them. I had crafted some theories, but I think those were the obvious ones. So it definitely took me by surprise when all of the reveals were made. And in regards to craft of character, I also think the story was phenomenal. I think having Alex as the main character, who is an outsider, who is someone that clearly did not grow up within this world, she clearly does not understand the ins and outs of it, I think that gave the story the opportunity to kind of be impartial and to tell the story in a little bit more of an objective way. Alex is literally a survivor, and I think that's one of the aspects of the story that I enjoyed the most. Alex as a main character is just, again, phenomenal. She's fantastic, she's outstanding, and I love the journey that she goes through throughout this entire book. I think particularly with Alex, with the way that she grew up and the fact that she could see ghosts from a very early age and that she had to suffer through all of that. She was literally a victim of circumstance. I think Alex has been just surviving her entire life, and I love the way that at the end of the book she realized that surviving was not living. Granted, Alex is reckless, she doesn't know when to stop, but what else is new? But I also do feel like she has a grounded head, and she is always aiming to do the right thing for everyone, even if she needs to put herself at risk. And I think her whole journey was just really engaging overall, because you see Alex go through a variety of emotions throughout the story. You see her being scared of what she can do, of what she can see, to going to a place where she reluctantly becomes the hero of the story, where she suddenly realizes that surviving is not living and that she needs to own up to her abilities. And going along those lines, no spoilers, because this is obviously a spoiler-free review, but those last scenes when we started getting reveal after reveal after reveal, Alex though, sis really popped off, okay? She really did that. I was shocked. I could not believe what I was reading. I was screaming. I was screeching. I was doing all the things. And talking about Alex as a main character is where we get into a lot of those trigger warnings, into a lot of those themes about drug abuse and overdose and use, because from a very young age, since Alex knew that she could see ghosts and she didn't really want anything to do with it, it definitely scared her. She did not know how to handle that particular situation. She was always trying to figure out how to dim those voices so that she could completely block them out. And she very early on found out that one way to do that was by consuming drugs. And so she gets entangled with these group of people that are older than her, and that type of behavior definitely robs onto Alex, and she thinks that it's the right thing to do just to suppress that ability and that power that she has. And because Alex is so scared of these ghosts, of these grays, because she had certain experiences with them that were definitely scarring for her, that is what makes the book even more eerie and scary. Because we follow Alex so closely, you can definitely tell how scared she is of all of these things. You can smell, you can feel, you can see that fear as these scenes start progressing, both in present time and in the past time, because we do have alternating timelines and flashbacks. We have winter, which is the current timeline, and then I think it's last spring, if I'm not mistaken. Last something, that is the past, and then we have proper flashbacks into her past. Other characters characters in this book again go along the lines of Darlington and Dawes, and Detective Turner in particular was a character that I liked his character. I think he was just too morally proper for the setting of this book. We already have Alex, who is doing this kind of like as an unwilling partner, and then we have Darlington, who believes he's doing the right thing, and then we have Dawes, who clearly just is in that, but she kind of wants to be out of that. If they really wanted to highlight how corrupt the law enforcement aspect really is, I think that character should have been maybe darker and should have taken more advantage of every single situation happening around him. Dawes is another character that was very prominent in the story, and she was definitely a helping hand throughout everything. I think she had a very kind of like motherly, sisterly feel to her. She was definitely that reassuring character, that nurturing character. She is committed to her duty, and she will do anything to protect Alex throughout the entirety of the story. And then Darlington. Ooh, Darlington. If you know anything about me, I love me a dark, broody character, and Darlington just checked every single box within that list. I think there was some aspect of Darlington that just drew you to him. He was definitely a compelling character, and I definitely needed to know more about Darlington as I kept reading. And I think towards the middle end of the story, we really got to see his background, where he comes from, and his real story as opposed to what Alex is perceiving. And knowing that from Darlington allows you to see exactly how similar yet different he is from Alex, and why they get along so well, and why there's that sense of understanding. And their relationship definitely evolved throughout the book. We see them kind of enter this place of, I guess, rivalry, enemies, just because there is a level of jealousy and envy from Darlington's end, because he definitely sees Alex's gift, and he sees all that she can do, and he wants that. And he is always wondering how she got that naturally instead of artificially, which is how he got his gift. And then they kind of shift to this place of being friends. And friends is a very loose word. I think there is that sense of understanding, and I see you and you see me, and we are similar in many ways. You think there are certain aspects of their personality that mirror each other. I was so heartbroken. For those of you who have read the book, you know, I was so heartbroken with that bathroom scene. It just completely shattered my heart, and you could feel her desperation, and you could feel her sadness and her lack of comprehension into what was happening. And it was just so frustrating and sad to read about. I was definitely not expecting that scene at all. But also that Halloween scene with Darlington and Alex, that scene was kind of hot, I'm not gonna lie. And then the morning after, when Alex tells Darlington something along the lines of, stop that and fuck me or completely cut that off, I was just flustered. And the fact that there is absolutely no romance in this book, like there is nothing romantic about this. There is some sort of like foreshadowing to things that maybe could happen in the future, but as of now, in the world that is just established in book one, there is no romance. But that particular scene, hey, it had me bothered. And this might sound crazy, but whenever I look at world building, do I think, is it believable? Like, can I actually believe something like this would be possible? Is it cohesive? And when I think of Ninth House, with how crazy and out there people are with their own agendas, I can totally believe this happening. Again, putting aside some details, like some of the societies turn into wolves and whatnot, if I put that aside and I literally just take the elements of Dark Academia that the book has, kind of scary, but really believable. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the review, there are trigger warnings for this book, and there were actually a lot more than I was anticipating. But I think when you talk about Dark Academia and you talk about these stories that are very dark in their nature, I think trigger warnings and darker themes are to be expected, and they definitely were a constant throughout the story. And again, if you can't stomach any of these, I definitely warn you with reading the book, because Bardugo does go in detail into all of these, and they get pretty graphic as the story goes on. So just be mindful of these trigger warnings if you are interested in picking up this book. So the first two themes that we have, and these are themes that definitely kept popping back into the story, are rape and sexual assault. And this book is definitely a strong commentary into rape culture. They do go into detail throughout the majority of the novel. You see both the setup and the action. Then we've got substance abuse, drug use, abuse and abuse. And again, themes that definitely come up again and again in the story. As I told you guys before, with Alex's storyline in particular, we really do see her journey with consuming drugs and abusing them with this group of friends that she created when she was younger. And as part of the magic system, there is also that use of substances and abuse of them in order to not only acquire your powers, but also suppress them or amplify them. There is obviously gore, murder, there's mutilation in here. There is also the mention of suicide, and there is also self-harm. So there are quite a bit of trigger warnings in this book. Again, be mindful of all of them before you dive in. Now, in conclusion, to start wrapping it up, because I am literally gonna do mascara and then lips, so I don't got that much to go. I really enjoyed this book. I think it was definitely one of the best books that I have read so far this year. That is not to say a lot. I've only read like 8 books this year so far. I really enjoyed it. I think it was a great, nice first taste at dark academia. It definitely teased me to carry on with this subgenre of gothic literature and find out more about what these stories have to offer. I think if you're like me and you like a lot of themes addressed in the story and you like a lot of darker elements, I think you definitely enjoy this book. That is certainly why I enjoyed it a lot. Also, safe to say, I am definitely looking forward to the sequel of Ninth House, which does not have a publication date. We do not know when we're getting it, but you better bet when that is announced, it will be pre-ordered. I will be reading it as soon as it gets here. I obviously, if you follow me on Goodreads, if you've been on my live streams, you know what I rated this book already. I definitely gave this book a 5 out of 5 stars. I think it was a very stellar read. I think it just gave me everything that I was looking forward with Dark Academia, with an adult book from Leigh Bardugo. But yeah, anyway, before I keep babbling on about absolutely nothing, I'll finish off my eyes, do my lips off camera, and I'll come back with y'all and just wrap it up. And here we go. This is the finished look. I really do feel like it captures the essence of Dark Academia. Very sophisticated and fancy persona. So I hope you guys enjoyed this first installment into the Makeup Monday series, where I do my makeup and I review a book at the same time. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Comment down below what you think of this new series. Again, Makeup Monday. If you reach the end of the video, comment down below some quote emojis if you know which one I'm talking about. But also let me know if you've read Ninth House, what you thought of it, or if you were looking forward to reading this book, because I definitely want to hear all of your thoughts. Don't forget to subscribe down below for more bookish content. I am constantly uploading videos that I'm sure you do not want to miss, as well as live streaming throughout the week. You guys already know the deal. And you can also follow me on all my social medias, which are always linked down below. I love you guys so, so much, and I will see you on the next one. Bye, guys.